Hello, welcome back to DeAnn's Art Studio. I'm DeAnn Mealy. I'm still on location at the Jansen Art Studio in Elizabethtown, Pennsylvania, where I'm sharing a few of the techniques that I use with you and answering some of the questions I've been receiving for a while via email and on social media. In my last video I posted, we talked about the large brush techniques that I use from Paint It Simply, where painting rows with one large brush. I think I actually used two. I sneak a smaller one in every now and then. I strictly adhered to the Paint It Simply palette, the basic colors of the Heritage paints. We'll be using those today as well, but I also want to augment with a couple extra special colors that I like to use just to give everything a little pop. And so with it being springtime and the colors are, there's such a wide array of colors out there, we definitely need to have a little pop. So let's review some of our colors that we were using. We'll be using still the basic six, like I said. We are going to use the Hansa Yellow, Naphthol Red Light, Red Violet, Phthalo Blue, Titanium White, and Carbon Black. And like I said in the first video that I posted, I went a little more into depth about these colors, and we talked about globalizing them, which I will be globalizing again today, which just simply means that I'm going to replace some of the water that's in these paints with some extender, and it just gives me a little more open time. Now, when I'm painting the pillow, I'm not going to use any kind of fabric medium. This pillow is actually a faux suede that I purchased from a local department store. And there's really no need for me to worry about the paints ever coming out. First of all, if you let paint dry and cure into your clothing, you know how that works. It's the laws of nature. It's never going to come out. So we don't wash these pillows. They're just for home decor. And I love the faux suede because you are actually able to draw your pattern on or give yourself some guidelines into the suede. It's a little more forgiving. And so I highly recommend the first time maybe you find something similar and give that a try. So let's switch down to the down camera so you can see the suede. So you can see that it has a suede finish to it. And what I like to do, and I show my students this and in seminars quite often, is I'll take and just kind of brush the suede over all in one direction so that there's a little nap to it. And see, if I pull down on it, hopefully you can see that, there'll be a little difference in the nap so I can draw a circle. And that's a little way to cheat if you're real uncomfortable with how you're going to, the placement of your flowers on your pillow. Now this is in a, like a steel blue, so we're just gonna go for it and see what we come up with today. Now I have put my colors out on my palette, so I'll be bringing my palette over to show you. The two colors that I've added are Cerulean Blue. It is a little more expensive of a color because of the pigments that are in it, and also Quinacridone Violet. And neither of these will we use very much of, so you won't need to have very much of that out on your palette. Again, the colors are globalized, so I've extended the open time by replacing the water with some extender. I'm going to start out using a 3/4 inch flat, fusion flat brush, and like I said before, mine are very well worn. There's no reason to throw out a brush like this when it starts getting a little flare or flip into it, because this will just make better flowers. And we're going to be using this on the nap of this fabric, so we want to feel good about using these brushes on the fabric. Canvas brushes, those kind of things, they all just seem to train your brushes, so never get rid of those. And you'll see the corner of mine, hopefully, let me hold it up for you. The corner of mine is really, really flared quite a bit, and that's because I use the corner of my brush often when I'm softening. Now, when I'm brushing through this with my hand, I'm thinking of the placement of a flower. And what I'm thinking is maybe I would want to do one maybe right here. Maybe a rose. We'll just go with a big rose today and pull a stem down. You can kind of see that on your camera there. And maybe I'll have some leaves, just a little bit of leaves. This is just give me some guidelines. Do not sweat it. It doesn't really matter. Like I told you before, a lot of these things are practice. Now you're thinking, we're practicing on my pillow. Well, don't forget, your pillow does have two sides. So you have two sides to practice on, and that's okay. I haven't had any problems with it. You can have happy accidents, then we'll show you how to turn some of those accidents into great creative leaves and those kinds of things. I do use extender in my brush, and I pinch wipe often with my paper towel. So make sure you have plenty of paper towels on hand. You're gonna dip into extender. work it into your brush, and then you're going to lightly pinch wipe. Remember I told you before, don't over pinch and break that brush or pull those bristles out, because we can do that when we get a little too excited, a little too anxious with our paints and what we're doing. To start with, I'm going to kind of just figure out where my rose is going to go. And we talked before about having a light source. And on this pillow, I'm not going to worry too much about that at this point. I'm going to just kind of go with my warms and cools. Red violet is the coolest color on your palette. So I'm going to take it, and I'm thinking maybe this part of my flower will be in the shadow. So I'm going to cup in some red violet. I want it to point this way, and if you have trouble and you always get your rose or your flower straight like this, and every time the center is right there, give yourself a little mark, or if you have to give yourself a little arrow to tell you, hey, point that opening out, then do so. That's no big deal. Now, I'm going to fluff this color out, and you can see it's going to dry quite often just because of the nap of the pillow. So I'm going to just keep working more and more paint. With the pillow, you do have to get quite a bit of paint on it, because some of it will soak in just a wee bit. And the more paint I get on the pillow, the easier it's going to be to work with it later. I'm going to go into some naphthol red light. I'm going to work that over, brush mix it just a little bit over there close to my red violet, and put that maybe on the other side. And you guys know last time from my videos, and maybe if you've watched a lot of the stuff I've been posting on Facebook and all, you know that I really, really like red. Now, this is going to soak down into your pillow a little bit, and that's just the nature of fabric. It's okay. So you may have to go back, dip into a little extender. I always work from the center as I'm working out, and then just kind of fluff the edges. If you use too much extender, you might get a little bit of a bleed out, you know, out towards the edge, maybe beyond. Your rose may kind of grow bigger than what you want it to, which is okay. We can always adapt and adjust for those kinds of instances. And I'm going to really get a lot more paint here. Dip in, work it into some extender. You can see over my palette right here that I'm working some extender into it. And I'm just going to work. I have little goobers in my paint right there, and that's okay. Gives a little texture, or if that bothers you, just flick them out. And wipe your brush. Don't forget to pinch wipe. Everything you're doing is going to kind of dirty up just a little bit. Now, my pillow is coming through, and in this case the pillow can kind of act like a toner. So when you're painting, you know that when we're painting we always have either our background can come through, and that can tone all of our colors together. We can marry our colors together with different colors, earth colors, or maybe we used to call it one mother color or whatever. In this case, the color that kind of tends to bleed through is the pillow color. So the pillow blue in a way is going to act as our toner, so not to worry if some of that color starts coming through. Now right now I have my rose is actually divided right down the center, perfect, which is really not something that I think is the most pleasing to the eye. So I'm going to continue to work some of this naphthol red light over into my red violet just a little bit. All right, now, start thinking kind of casual. You may not be able to get as casual on the fabric. We may end up with a little bit tighter round rose just because it's the nature of the fabric. And if it's your first time painting, first of all, painting this style, painting with these acrylics, you know, you might find that a little bit different, a little bit more difficult for you, and that's okay. Just work on brushing it out. And keep adding color, and you can see it soaking in. Now my color is wet, because see, if I take and rub my finger on that, I'm still picking up the paint. So as it's soaking in, I'm feeding it more and more paint, so I'm still getting some color to work with. Man, my naphthol red light is pretty thick. Now I do tend to keep my paints a little thick, so we can all understand where that's coming from right now. Now, as I'm doing this, I'm thinking maybe I want to go ahead and establish and figure out where the stem of my rose may come in, and you're not going to be tied to this. Remember I told you before, in this line, black and Hansa yellow, carbon black and Hansa yellow, make a really pretty toned green. And we also have in the mixes, or you can brush mix 2-to-1 naphtha red light with carbon black, and you'll get a really nice base brown. And I happen to have a little of it over here on my palette, so I'm just going to reach for that in the interest of saving some time. You can reach over and get a little bit of brown. So I'm going to have olive green and a little bit of brown into it. So I'm just trying to get something that's not too stark. And remember, we set our openings here. So if that's my growth point, I just want to give myself a little idea where my stem may come from. That's a really big rose for a pretty short stem, but that's okay. It's going to be a kind of a fantasy rose anyway. We're painting it on a pillow, right? Now, I've been talking, and that paint on my flower is probably starting to set up just a little bit. So I'm going to feed it lightly. I'm starting to lighten my touch. I'm feeding it, modeling in a little more of that naphthol red light onto my rose. And notice that I'm kind of putting more of it over to maybe a warm side, maybe down to the base. I'm trying not to make a perfect circle. The brush marks just add character and charm to your rose, if you will. So brush marks are your friend, so leave them. There's no problem with that. I may take right now, it might be a good time to take this pretty olive green, and that's a warm green, that black and yellow, and I have the brown in it right now. It makes a pretty a warm green color, and I'm going to slide just a little of that up under my rose, just starting to kind of cover some of my holidays that are up under there. Now the blue coming through is okay, and the warmth of this green on that blue is going to really show up nice. So that gives you a really pretty color. I have not painted actually on the blue pillow, and these pillows do come in a variety of colors. There's one that is called, I believe it's called a sand or sable color. It makes a beautiful background for poppies, orange colors, maybe a hibiscus would be a really pretty subject matter to put on something that color. So you may want to do something like that in the future. I'm also thinking that I need to probably lightly give you the idea of where I'm going to head. I might need some other little flower out this way. I'm going to scribble just a little bit. And yeah, I use the word scribble, which is okay. I'm going to pull some of these yellow greens down. I got a little too much black. And remember, black in this line is pretty powerful, carbon black, as is phthalo blue. But I can make that olive green and cool it down with some of my phthalo blue and just come in and maybe slide. That gives me a really pretty, very cool green right there. So that makes it kind of nice. So I get a little temperature change. And, you know, if you were just starting out and you were like, oh, I love the pillow, you just want to emulate what I'm doing, that's okay. All of those temperature ideas and some of these concepts, they come with practice. They come with the more you paint, the more you brush mix and all, the more you get used to the paint, the more your eye gets trained. You're training your eye to start seeing temperature. You start seeing value. You start seeing a lot of things about the paint. I only paint with one brand of paint, the Heritage Multimedia Acrylics. For one thing, I actually, it's one of the best brands out there, and a fine, pure, artist quality pigments, and they're non-toxic, and so painting with one brand, using this line, I actually have learned everything I need to know about them. I'm mastering my tools, if you will. So if you switch back and forth between a lot of different media, you switch between different brands, you know, different brushes. One thing about knowing art and learning art and becoming an artist is really to get in there and learn your tools, know your pigments, know your brushes, know what's going to happen if you take and paint on a surface such as a pillow, switching over to canvas, switching over to a canvas board. So I highly recommend these paints, and you can't emulate the techniques with any other brand because of the viscosity and the quality of the pigment that's in the paint. So they're made with the same pigments that we find in oil paints, and these are non-toxic, and they don't take days and days to dry. So really, you have the best of both worlds right here. I'm going to pick up a little more yellow green, and the reason I was talking to you a little bit and let my piece set just for a few minutes is because then as it starts to set up, I'm able to start lightening my touch and actually paint under it. Now that looks extremely neon to you on the monitor, but that's okay because I like to overstate. So I'm going to come back in and pull in just a little bit of the green that I'm going to cool it up just a little bit, and start pulling some warms and cools under. It's still a little neon, so a little bright for me. Neon, intense, you know that artist term, right? Intensity. Intensity refers to how light or, how bright or dull your paint is, whereas value refers to how light and dark it is. So you'll see, you'll hear artists speak of the intensity of paint versus the value of paint. So that way you'll know exactly what they're talking about in the future. So intensity is how intense, how bright and dull, and value is how light and dark something is. I'm going to move this yellow green, this kind of bright green, around my piece a wee bit. And sometimes, now I have this laying flat under the camera, so let me pick it up so you can see how wet, see the wetness. And it's got a pretty good sheen to it right there. Pinch wipe often. So I'm going to start working on petaling my rose. And I'm going to go into the white and pick up white on my brush. And now my white is pretty thick. And you know in the other video I showed you that it was about to drip off as far as toothpaste, though. It isn't dripping. It's actually like chunky, thick white, the consistency of toothpaste. Now, this brush, something's wrong with it right at the moment. It is all white. If I go into this rose with all of this white on my brush right at this very moment, I'm not going to be a happy camper because it is just going to be very chalky sitting on top. There's no other color modeled into my brush, mottled. I want to have a variation of colors and values, hues and values in my brush. So I'm going to pinch wipe and go back into that white just a bit. Maybe pick up some of my naphthol red light. And I got some black in my brush because I'm painting kind of tight over there and I want it a little more pure. So I'm going to pick up some of that white and my naphthol red light. And before I start petaling, I'm going to start popping just some lightness right around. Notice that I haven't put a center into my rose yet. Sometimes as artists, and if you have been painting any other techniques, we get stuck in those techniques and we start always putting a center in and then our rose becomes a big ball. So I have started just kind of indicating my center at a later date, which right now might be good, but I'm not gonna do this and circle, circle, circle. I'm just gonna tap it in and just give my idea, you know, this is where the dark part of the rose is. Now, I told you I had a couple special colors on my palette. And by special, you know what DeAnn means. I mean that we're going to pop those babies just a bit. Now, if you don't like a lot of pop and a lot of contrast, that's okay. You can dull your colors down by not going to the next color, which is going to be quinacridone violet. And quinacridone violet gives you the most pretty pinks. And you're looking at this saying, well, we have a lot of warm reds on here, which is great, but I need to cool them down. And when I cool them, I want to have a little bit of a pop. And I really think that a pink, almost to like a Pepto-Bismol kind of pink, will really look nice on this blue. So let's go for that and see what we come up with. I'm going to reach over, and quinacridone violet, it's really a beautiful, beautiful color. And you can buy that in the tube. We'll put the links down at the bottom in the description here, so you can link right over to the website and order all the supplies you might need. And if you don't want to add these two colors, you just need the basic six of Heritage, so not to worry about that at all. Now, quinacridone violet. Before I go into that white, I'm going to take this quinacridone and I'm just going to keep it over on the cool side of my rose, maybe tickle it, play with fire a little bit, and put it over on that warm side. I am going to pinch white. I do need to give an indication, I think, at this point of maybe a drop petal. Maybe I want to drop a petal down, you know, reaching petals, okay? Drop petals, reaching petals, whichever terminology you like, of reaching down below the bowl of the brush and the shadow, below the shadow area. And so I'm going to reach down with some of that color. And that was kind of naphthol red light and a dirty brush. I think I could actually get away with popping it with some of that quinacridone violet. Ooh, that's going to be really rich and yummy color right there. Very lush. And since that is so lush, I'm putting a little more of it on because, you know, can't have too much. A girl can't have too much pink or violet or red as far as I'm concerned. Now, I may take right now, because I got that violet everywhere, I'm going to pull some more. And all I'm doing is just giving my rose a nice modeling effect and a variation of colors before I start petaling it. And by petaling it, I just mean that we're going to start drawing in and giving it some petals to work with so that it actually starts looking more and more like a rose. Now, you'll notice that the leaves that I have here, they don't really look like leaves, but because I've told you this is a rose, and you know we're painting a rose, and if most people will see a rose and they'll see leaves. So you really don't have to go back and define these leaves to the extreme, okay? So if you are uncomfortable with it, you can come back in and give yourself a little bit of maybe some long veins or just move quickly. I do think my stem might be a little bit, a little dark right there. So I might want to come in, it's not popping yet. I may want to come in with just a little bit of, maybe add some white in my brush. There we go. And in that dirty green, maybe pull a few highlights. You can run your finger through it a little bit. And not to worry about whatever's happening with the pillow. That nap is just something really nice to work with. You can add some white to your dirties and give yourself an indication of where some of your leaves are. And what happens with this, I just put a lot of paint over on my rose, and so I thought, well, maybe we can state some of those greens just a little bit before we move over to petaling our rose. Now, I'm going to pick up a little more of this quinacridone and model it back in so it's nice and fresh. I feel like I lost my dark a little bit on this cool side, so I'm taking that red violet. Remember, it's the coolest color on our palette, and I'm going to work it over on the side and around into that dark area right through there. Now, if you take and make a big smile, like we do when we're first learning, you're going to end up with very much a bald rose. And that, you know, there's really nothing wrong with that. We've done that like that. I've painted it that way for a long, long time. But I've become more impressionistic, a little less stylized, I think, as far as having a round shape. And I want my roses to casual. And so that's kind of one of the key things that I do in order to make sure I keep everything a little more casual. Now, I'm going to pick up some white. And I'm going to go into that quinacridone. I want you to see how bright. I've got some pink happening here. I'm going to pinch wipe that off now that I have it modeled over on the palette. And I'm going to model it on my brush. And if you sit there and blend on your palette, this is what happens. If you sit here and you take this paint and you keep going like this, we're all going to get one flat color. And it also, the more colors you mix together, the dirtier your color gets. And there are a lot of artists who like to paint with pop. And the key to having pop is, first of all, having paint that won't melt into each other. It doesn't run together. These acrylics will sit on top of each other. You control the pressure on your brush. And you also don't overblend on your palette. Remember, your painting pretty much happens over here on your palette. So we don't want to see you blend some more. Everything's one color, and then you come over to your flower. And so if that happens to you, you just restate with some more pure, come back in that quinacridone, restate it, no big deal. And you can restate some of your red light, naphthol red light if you'd like, back and forth. And then you have a dirty brush again. Okay, you have a dirty brush. I have a dirty brush with a lot of bright colors on it, right? You might have to come in and restate some of those cools right through there. You can use your finger at this point on your pillow. Now, one thing you may notice is I am not going all the way out to these edges and really, really pulling all the time. I love this lost and found edge. Now, when we are on a canvas or we are on a board or whatever, a different type of surface that's not as porous, we can obviously take our fingers and we can push and we can lose edges. We can pull background into it and soften edges. This is my background. This is my background color, which I do not have right at the moment. It's the pillow. So I'm keeping my brush. I fluff my edges to make it kind of look lost. That's a little technique to adapt, a way to adapt the Paint It Simply techniques and some of the other techniques to a pillow such as this, a surface. So keep that in mind. I'm going to scoop, and I kind of got a little bit of a ridge. If you can, you should see it. It's awesome. There we go. I tell my students that all the time when they're, you're off camera. Oh, well, it'll be okay. There's your Pepto-Bismol pinkish color. Now, I'm going to go in and petal this rose, and I'm kind of sitting down right now. So I'm going to stand up, and you can't see me stand up because I'm off camera, but I'm over my piece so that I can see, and you can see as well. And I'm going to strike in. Now, that's a pretty bright pink. Pinch wipe, and then this is my growth point. So I'm going to pull a couple times. Now, I did tell you in the other videos, and if you've ever been in my classes, that if you go in and you strike and then you go in and pull, try to do it three times. So when you strike, that's one, two, three, until you get used to the technique. Once you're used to the technique and you're controlling the pressure on your brush, it'll be much easier for you to tickle the surface with your brush a little bit more before you come out of it. The pillow, though, remember, is absorbing some of this paint and all, so we want to really make sure we have an angel kiss touch and that we are really lightening up so we don't push all of our paint into the pillow. All right, so now you can see I'm petaling just a bit. I can start lightening it up. I'm staying away from the backside, and I can see that this is dry, but not completely dry. You can see it's on my finger. So I'm going to come back into that in just a couple seconds, but I wanted to go ahead and get some lighter petals happening on the front of my rose here. Now, I am actually brushing mine more than what I authorized you to do. So, and that's because I've been doing this for quite a bit, and I can tell my touch, I'm lightening my touch as I do that. I just varied my brush a little bit by putting it into some red violet, dirty brush. I'm not even cleaning my brush right now, and pulling my color over. Now, I'm starting to get one variation of a very cool flower, which is fine. The coolness, I think it's an innate idea. My brain is telling me, my mind's eye saying, cool it down, cool it down. This is where you want to make sure you trust your palette and not so much your eye. However, this is a blue canvas. It's very cool. So if I come in here and paint a really bright naphtha red light rose on here, I'm going to have a temperature contrast, and it's really going to stand out a lot. So I tend to innately tone these things down as I'm painting, and we'll cool it just a bit. But I still have the warmth at that naphtha red light in there, so you can still see that. Now, I have a dirty brush, and I'm just wiped it and then picked up a little more. I'm going to start pulling this around just a little bit. I'm going to pick up a little more white, and you can petal this as much to your little heart's content. Just remember that as you pull each layer, you want to lighten your touch, because you're going to dig through. And you can easily on this dig down into all the way to the blue fabric. Also, if you're using your fingers to blend, which we've been doing a lot of that, if you use your fingers to blend, you can easily dig all the way down to the blue as well, the fabric that's underneath. So you really must have paint built up before you start using your finger, and you have to lighten your touch quite a bit. All right. I'm going to pick up some more quinacridone, and I just kind of work back and forth until I start getting a look that I like and that's kind of pleasing to my eye. I'm going to start fluffing my edges out here because I can't negative back into it. Let's see, that side is a little warm, so maybe I want to go into my quinacridone over with a little naphtha red light. And this is all developing. My painting is developing with you. The idea is, my students say all the time, she just goes for it. I'm not afraid, it's just paint. And you'll say, well, you know, yeah, but you're on a pillow, and boy, we all know that fabric's not gonna be as forgiving. Well, we have fixing techniques, so I'm not really worried about it. We can add greenery around it. We can fluff it out with another flower, some baby's breath, whatever. So don't let that stress you out too much, okay? The fabric's not forgiving, but there's always something you can do. And if you get lost with that, email me and show me a picture of it. And I'm happy to answer your questions, give you some ideas, and go from there. So now I'm building my dark again, restating it, and pushing that up into that flower. Okay, so I just pushed back and forth to push my darks up in there. I've been a little sneaky, a little kind of not going into my center very much, but I don't want to have a big dark hole. And when you come back from your piece and you see that there's a dark hole there, then that just tells you that you've stayed a little too light on your center. So don't be afraid. I want to grow this rose out. Don't be afraid to lighten up that center, okay? Now, as I'm growing it out, notice I'm really not getting a lot of hard edges. I'm just kind of letting that guy just kind of fluff. I think that's kind of pretty, just to fluff out on that pillow. Maybe you don't want to do it maybe to the same extent on both sides, but you can actually see that flower kind of open up. Remember, we gave the impression of a drop down here, but now that we're painting and this flower is evolving, I'm thinking I don't want quite as much contrast. Boy, do I have some really stickies in my paint today, which is kind of fun. It's moving back and forth, and I'm able to move it back and forth with my thumb as well. I might want to reestablish down here. I think I want to whiten the bowl of my rose just a wee bit, because if this is going to be sitting on a couch way over there and somebody walks into a room, I want them to really be able to see my rose. So if it's as the same value as my pillow, which look like it's probably like a 4 or 5, maybe a 5, and I paint a rose that doesn't have much contrast in it, then guess what? You're not going to be able to see it from across the room. It's just going to look like a pillow with something on it. Also keep in mind that you must have dark to see light. So anytime that you are losing your shadows, you want to make sure that you restate those. I'm going to get really brave now, and I'm going to pull in some center. I did not really go, sometimes I go into a yellow center. Maybe I'll do a yellow green. That looks kind of pretty. If you use that yellow green, it's on a dirty brush. You probably want to use it someplace else on your flower. So maybe I'll kiss it just a wee bit. Please notice I have not changed brushes. I'm doing this whole thing with one brush. How cool is that? I don't really like that too much, and that's no big deal. It's a pillow, so I can't really erase it or wipe it out. I just go and establish some color under it, or over it rather. And now that I'm starting to develop this, I think I do want to give you the idea that there's a petal down here. And I have a really big rose, so I'm going to really drop that petal on down and give it a little life, a little direction. I'm going to have to step back from it to see if I'm even, that's an impressionistic as anything, isn't it? I'm going back and forth with my lights and darks until I see something. This is a little out of kilter right there. So all you have to do is if my brush got a little crazy, that's an opportunity to come in and add some greenery. So I'm going to come in and I'm going to pick up some more yellow and black, which remember that made us a nice green. It's going to be a yellowy green. So I'm going to pick up a little bit of phthalo and cool that down. It might be a little bright, so maybe I'll put some red violet in it because the red violet and that green, red and green are complements, so they'll tone each other. I didn't go checking it way out here on the edge. I checked it right here, and that's going to work. So I'm going to add a little bit of green fluff, and once you do it, then you got to move it. I'm dropping everything off that paint right there, huh? Then you got to move it around. So maybe I want to casual out my flower just a wee bit. If I did that over there, I think I'm going to start casualing over here a little. And I have that kind of dark color, so I'm going to start trying to establish that a little bit down here in some of these stem. Ooh, I really like that's a little going a little more phthalo blue because of that blue background. That really gives a nice effect and to your flower, the leaves. So that worked out really, really nice. And you know, sometimes you don't know until you surface, and we don't know exactly how it's going to work into this pillow. Now, I'm starting to get close to being finished, and that was a pretty quick, just a little 32-minute painting. So I'm going to start evaluating it and seeing what else I might want to do to it. And I was standing up over my piece so I could see it, so I wouldn't tilt it and get it where you can't see it if I tilt that up. So you do kind of want to evaluate it. Now, I do see here with this pillow, and I don't want to, you know, it's just a quick little guy. I don't want to spend a ton of time. You could go and fluff some greenery up, and you could put another bud up in here and that would look great. Make sure if you do that, you don't line it up right even with it. You'd want to drop it down or pull it up. Ghost flowers do work pretty well on the fabric. I kind of like to keep it a little simple when I'm working on this. I would take some of this mix of pinks, and if you'll see up here, I have all my pinks. Oh, I should switch the camera so you can see. All my pink is up here, and there is no pink down here. I've isolated my color, so we really want to make it more pleasing by moving that color around. That doesn't mean you have to move it around as a bright, bright pink. You can move it just as little bit, hints of it here and there. You can do that too much, and I tend to go, ooh, a little is great, and more has got to be even better. So keep that in mind. Sometimes that isn't always the case. I think some of this quinacridone, let me check that out. Now that might be, that's a little bright. So if you do that, it's overstated, that doesn't matter. I just take my brush, come back in. Maybe I'll come in and get a little bit of a light green. And my brush is really, really dirty. So remember that red and green are complements, even if it's quinacridone. So it's gonna tone and not give you the color you're looking for. So don't worry about that. Just mix up, pinch wipe well. Not so well that you break your brush. Remember we talked about that, so don't go doing that. Mix yourself up another olive green. Maybe I'm going to cool that just a little bit and see if that can take and come over here and give me a more pleasing look. I'm not going to cover all of it up. Sometimes that's just a nice happy accident and you end up with some pretty. Now I really, really like that. That's giving me some nice contrast. The moral of this story is, if you're following along, is you can tell that I'm letting my painting talk to me. I'm not going to tell my painting what it needs. Your painting will tell you what you need. Sometimes you just got to stop and look at it and go, okay, well, DeAnn did this, but does yours really need to have that? Sometimes not so much. You may have to have something different on yours. If you are going to strike colors over other colors that are pretty wet, please make sure you lighten your touch quite a bit, because you will pick that up. I did a lot right there, and I probably should have stopped while I'm ahead. So while I was ahead, so I'm just gonna drag some color back through there. Not a big deal. Maybe I'll come up in here and do some little bit of negative painting and take a little of that back out. Since we have a little bit of greens up through here, I really feel like I should move my greens around. I don't want to make a halo, but I can sit here and I can fluff with the best of them. Let me tell you, really, really get some fluff going. Now we're almost there, so I'm evaluating. I think I want to do a little pop up through here. If I get a little too much, I'm just going to take my finger and wipe back into it. Maybe create a few more petals up through there. I just feel like I really want to have some more color happening. There we go. If you want to add more petals, you may. It's your piece. It's okay. I'm using just this one brush, so that makes it kind of fun. It's kind of neat to see. And it breaks a lot of habits. You know, if we're doing one thing all the time, change the way you're doing it. Use one brush and say, okay, I'm going to paint this entire flower with one brush. I guarantee you it will change how you're painting. And notice too that I'm way far back on my brush. I'm not choked way up on it. I'm looking for some variation of some white and reestablish some of my lights in this. And if you start getting a little too white, you can take and just touch it and blend it a little bit with your finger. Push back the colors. You can pull them and push them back, pull and push back and work back and forth. Whoops. See, now that's where a little bit tackiness started pulling the color off. So I'm going to just reestablish it. Now I see that there is a little bit of room right there that I can either carefully push it back. I love to push back and forth in my color. Now, to finish off the base of that, I'm going to take just a little bit of green, pull into it. I've really lightened my rose up, and you're going to be able to see it across the room for sure. I also need to be concerned about whether this center is a little too dark, so maybe I'll tickle some lights back into there, so that across the room, you know, it doesn't look like I have a big black hole. And that's what you got to consider, is just, you know, where is this going? How is it going to be viewed? Is it going to be viewed real close up all the time? It's on a couch or something, probably not. The leaves now do not have enough light in them now that I've lightened up everything. So I am going to go back and lighten those leaves up just with a little bit of yellow green right now. So I just want your eye to be able to see them. So, and if I might overstate it, and that's okay. You can go back and forth with this forever. At some point, you just got to put a fork in it, and call it done. We could stick it, right? Put a stick in it. That didn't make any sense at all. Put a fork in it and call that baby done, because we could play with it forever, and I can definitely play like with the best of them. And right now, I'm just looking to see if I can get some of this yellow green maybe fluffed up through here just a little bit. Got that maybe a little too light. And you just work back and forth, just as if you were on a canvas. You may have to pick up a little more color on your paintbrush. And I'm just looking for a dark color of green, just so I can pop. Oh, nice. See? Sometimes things, and I love just working back and forth. Back and forth. And you don't get excited. I got some colors under there. I'm like, oh, that really wasn't what I was looking for, and that's okay. Maybe I want to pull some of this down here. I'm telling you, I could do this all day long. I just love to paint, love to create, and love to share. So anyway, so there you go. There's probably a few things we could do. You may want to just let it start tacking up and get an idea if there's anything you need to adjust. I'm just thinking I need a little bit of Maybe some light right there. We did put cerulean, so since I have it on my palette at the very end, I love to take this color, and you're gonna have to do it very lightly, but just kind of pop some color. We used to call it reflective light. Pop some color in on your flowers. And no guts, no glory, but make sure you have a light touch, okay? So pop a little, oh, that's giving that a really, really nice look right there. And if you like bright, we definitely can do bright right now, right? I do think there's one other thing I'd love to do, and that would be maybe come back in. I'm going to assess the color right here. And I really think it's a little too bright, so let me dull that down just a bit. I'm dulling it down by adding white and also pushing harder on my palette with the dirty brush. So I'm not going to get excited about that being a little too Pepto-Bismol. But I'm looking just for some kind of hint of a petal that breaks away from the rest, just to give it a little interest. And since I did that, I may need it right here just a little bit, just to kind of, that's pretty. And now you can go back in if you want. And that one kind of goobered up there just a little bit. I'm going to drop to a number 10 flat and just kind of chisel on with some white. Just a few little petal indications right there. See, that can... And the paint needs to tack up a little bit. If it's tacking up in between some of these finishing layers, it really helps. But we're moving through with the video. So you're able to put me on pause and, you know, let yours tack up if you'd like. That's not a big deal. Or watch it through one time, come back, and try again. I didn't really, that white there, I want to really push my shadow up again. I'm lightening my touch because the fabric does feel a little different, but this is how I go about doing it. I'm thinking that's kind of made a really pretty flower. I may need some lights right through here. And so I'll let this start tacking up and I'll assess it. And if I need to fluff a wee bit back through here a little bit, a smidge I may, or if it can stay that way. I feel like I might need some more cools down on my leaves. Maybe I'll pick up some of that red violet. And that might be the perfect color with a little bit of dirty brush just to kick in there, here and there. But you can go back and forth and balance your colors out. If you see that you need to move a color a little bit, if it's isolated, you know, it's a pillow. We love to see some things drizzled along. So just kind of drizzle your colors and there you have it. And I think that's going to turn out. That's going to be nice and be able to see that across the room for sure. You can tweak it here and there. If you get your edges too light, take some of your greens and you can actually fluff green back into this and that kind of thing. That's how I go about softening a little bit. So hopefully you've enjoyed painting this flower as much as I've enjoyed sharing it with you. What a pretty spring flower for a sofa. If you let these dry, you could probably do the same techniques on something that has a little bit of a, you know, outdoor fabric. That would be kind of neat to put it out there. You know, I actually live in the South. I'm going to darken my stem while I'm talking to you. I actually live in the South and we love our porches. And in the historic area where I live, we have four porches and furniture and those kinds of things. And oh my gosh, you guys, we have to just, everything that you have on the inside, you want to carry it to the outside. So everybody's very, very proud of their porches and their flowers and their pillows and all your accessories. They're not just for the indoors anymore. So, well, I want to thank you for joining me again today. And I hope that you've enjoyed kind of seeing how I go about the pillow. There's so much that you can do with these paints. You're really not limited just to canvas. Use your imagination. If you have any questions, please feel free to email me and we'll put some of those links down at the bottom. And, so there you have it. We've painted a nice rose on a pillow. Again, if you have any questions, do ask. I invite you to visit me on my website at deannsartstudio.com. You can also follow me on Facebook. I have a blog that you can link from this YouTube channel. And please subscribe. Click up there and subscribe and share this with your friends, because once we hit a certain number, I think it's like 100, we can go live. And boy, wouldn't that be fun to go to get together live and paint a few things and share some ideas. So I hope to see you again soon. Thank you.